Welcome to the September 12th, 2016 meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. Could we have the roll call, please?
Council Chair McCausland.
Here.
Council Garvin.
Here.
Councilor Grennan.
Here.
Councilor Jordan.
Here.
Councilor Lennon.
Here.
Councilor Ray.
She will be 5 minutes late.
And Councilor Sullivan.
Here.
Thank you. Will you join me for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Do we have any town council reports and correspondence tonight? Yes, Patty.
Sure, I do. I actually have two. The first is regarding our upcoming community roundtable, which is going to, is set for a week from Monday, this Monday, September 19th, from 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. in the Cape Elizabeth School Cafetorium. And the goal of this meeting is to provide citizens with an opportunity to give us feedback on what they feel is important and to discuss and to include in our 2017 goal-setting process. The council will be there. Mike will be there. We should be there to guide the process and really want to hear what you feel is important. So we hope for a robust discussion and for a good turnout. Again, that's next Monday. The second committee report that I had is from the Alternative Energy Committee. Council, as you know, that we approved a committee charge in January. We slated a committee in February and began work in March, and we've had 6 meetings since March, one a month. And at this point, what we have, the committee really spent all this time discussing alternative energy options, and they really did an exhaustive and thorough job at looking at all those options were potentially. And at this point, what they really knew is that one of the big drivers was that this, whatever they brought forth, needed to be financially viable for our community. So they have, at this point, narrowed the selection to solar. They're looking at 3 components of solar, potentially, for this community. One would be on putting some solar on rooftops and municipal buildings and schools. A second, which would be a larger slightly, would be a microgrid somewhere on town land. And a third, potentially, would be a large array. Where we are now is looking at a cost-benefit analysis, doing a risk assessment, and hope to deliver a report by the deadline, which is December. However, we may be asking for an extension, but again, we can just kind of, I'll put that out there for now, but hopefully we'll make our deadline. So for now, the next meeting, in case anybody's interested in attending, it's a great conversation, is Tuesday, September 20th at 6:30 p.m. It'll be in the Jordan Conference Room.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes, Caitlin.
Just that the Ordinance Committee is meeting on Thursday at 1:30 right here at the Town Hall. In the we meet downstairs in the wonderful new room. Downstairs, and we'll be discussing the revamping of the sign ordinance.
Thank you. Anyone else? No? We'll move on to the next item, the Finance Committee report. Mike, are you giving us a presentation on that tonight, or is Kathy updating us?
Go ahead.
Yeah. No major update. Just wanted to mention that our audit is now nearly complete. We expect it within a week or two. We had good financial results. Expect to see the final draft any day now. Other than that, our revenues are holding up. Expenditures, no big surprises. The summer projects are coming along well and within budget.
Great. Thank you. Any questions for the manager? Nope. Okay. We will move on to the next item, which is citizen opportunity for discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there anyone here who'd like to speak tonight to something that's not on the agenda? No? Yes? Step up to the podium, please. Give us your name, your address, your affiliation if you have one. Try to limit your remarks to 3 minutes or less. Thank you.
Thank you very much, councilors. My name is Mark Mayone. I represent Spurwink Rod and Gun Club. And in that capacity, I have had the I've had the great honor and the luck to be able to deal with Mike McGovern. And I have yet to have met a more fair, impartial, strong-willed, absolutely true to Cape Elizabeth person than he is. And I would like to extend a thank you for your dealings that we've had. I know I've not been happy with a lot of them, or some of them. But Cape Elizabeth is going to have a very large set of shoes to fill when you leave. And I just would like to thank you from our little area on the other side of the town that for your fairness and for your guidance, although at times it didn't seem like guidance. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Patty, would you like to say something?
Well, on the tail of that nice thank you to Mike, I think I speak for the council, and we'll hear more of it, how thankful we are for Mike for his service. But I did want to let the community know that there will be a public celebration to honor Mike's service and work here in our community. It will be on Tuesday, December 6th from 5 to 7 at Paputa Club. There will be a public notice to the community, but I thought it was a great opportunity to share that news. So I'll add our thanks. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other members of the public who would like to speak about something not on the agenda? No? We will move on to the town manager's monthly report. Michael?
Yes. Thank you, Chair McCausland. And I'll be very brief, but I will follow up on the comment that Mark Mayon just made a little bit. You know, it's no secret that I have announced that I plan to step down the end of the year. But I just want to relate a little story of something that happened 31 years ago. The town manager before me was a gentleman by the name of John Hinchy, who's a wonderful man, great mentor to me, and I think an excellent town manager. And after he announced that he was leaving, he was here for, I don't know, about 3 weeks to a month. I don't remember the exact time, but a woman came into the office one day, who's since passed on quite a few years ago, and she hadn't always got along with him. So she came in, and back then we had secretaries, and she asked the secretary, Polly Neipert, could she see the town manager? And Polly said, oh, let me check, see if he's available. So he was, and the woman went in the office, and she proceeded to tell John Hinchy that she was so pleased to meet him and that there was a new town manager because the other one was just so bad and so terrible and had never helped out. So the rest of the story is about 2 months later, she comes in again and the same thing, I'd like to see the town manager. And Polly comes in and says, it's her. So anyway, she comes in to me and she looks at me with this strange look and she says, you're the town manager? Oh, never mind. So anyway, I just wanted to let everyone know I'm here to December 31st and hope no one makes that same mistake that year.
I'm sure no one will.
So that's my report.
Nothing else?
No. Right. Oh, one other quick thing. I do want to mention that in addition to some of the things the council mentioned, we did have four very interesting forums over the month of August. Mm-hmm. The first one actually was Garden Club one on Wintermoth. We then had a hunting forum. Sarah was there and others, which was very interesting, looking at hunting and archery issues in town and the rights and responsibilities of both hunters and property owners. And we had a state wildlife biologist there, a game warden and a supervisor of game wardens, and it was a very interesting session and had a little over 30 people there. It was nice to see, and nice to see the cooperation of the state. There was also a public forum on this proposal that some of you may have read about in the Courier for Kevin Amphitheater at Fort Williams. That also attracted about 30 people, and the Fort Williams Advisory, the Fort Williams Park Committee, I'll have to get used to it, mm-hmm, is meeting this Thursday night to review comments from that forum, and we would expect a recommendation to the town council shortly thereafter, probably for the October meeting. And finally, there was a forum on pool issues. There's concerns about lane use and some of those issues, and again, that one, I think had about 40 individuals came to it. So it was just a nice way to get public input on specific issues, and I would encourage in the future the council to do that on issue-specific items, you know, before they get settled too far down the road to get early public input. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions for the manager? No? We'll move on to the review of the draft minutes of the August 8th meeting. Do I have a motion to accept those meeting minutes?
So moved.
Thank you. Do I have a second? Thank you, Sarah. Any discussion about those meeting minutes? No? All in favor? None opposed? Thank you. We will move on to our public hearing on paper streets. I'm just going to say a couple of things before I open the public hearing. I want to mention that the council has been working on this project for several months, I'd say for 5 or 6 months so far this year. I know many of you have attended the one of the neighborhood meetings. We had a series of them over 3 or 4 months in the spring and early summer. We are looking forward to receiving your comments tonight. I'm not anticipating that we will be having a vote, although we'll see what happens. We do have an agenda item for tomorrow night's workshop to recap and review the discussions that we've had and to review and revisit any comments that we hear from all of you tonight. And I think we're anticipating that we will be taking a vote at our October 5th meeting. So tonight we will open the public hearing and look forward to hearing comments, but I am not anticipating that we'll be voting tonight. With that, I will open the public hearing. I'm guessing there are a number of people who would like to get up and speak, and I will just remind folks, again, if you're going to speak, please come up to the podium, give us your name, your address, try to limit your remarks to 3 minutes or less. And Jessica, do you still have a timer on your phone that makes a nice buzzing noise that reminds people of when the 3 minute limit? Would you manage that for us tonight?
Sure.
Great. And with that, I will open the public hearing. Please come right up to the podium. I'm sure there are a number of folks who'd like to speak. And to keep things moving along, if you are going to speak, you might want to line up behind the existing speaker.
Good evening, Council. My name is Andy Bernstein. I live at 19 Trundy Road, Cape Elizabeth, which is U12-2 on the Paper Street list. And my wife and I share that driveway with 17 Trundy Road, the Robinsons. We've been together as neighbors and for 30 years. Never had any issues between us. The Robinsons would be here tonight, but they're quite elderly, and Mr. Robinson has some health issues. So they asked me to also say that my remarks represent their position as well. As we understand the paper road rules, there is no buildable lot behind us. There's a house behind us. There is no sewer line down the driveway. There's no public water, Portland Water District issues. In fact, the Portland Water District has listed in the documents the paper streets that they would like to see retained, and we're not one of them. There's no turnaround in our driveway. There's no trail direction or location to open space or green belt or trail or anything behind our driveway. And looking at the criteria, there's no pedestrian access to open space. So it seems like all the reasons to retain this as a paper street don't exist. So for those reasons, my wife and I, Carl and I, simply ask that you vacate U12-2 as a paper street. Again, it's just our private driveway shared with 17 Trundy Road. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. Otherwise, that's really all I wanted to say.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name's Evan Mitchell. I'm the owner of the house at 34 Stone Drive. Abutting my house is a paper street, and it's identified as Stone Drive South. And I notice on the printout, that I took off the internet regarding all of the paper streets, that it was accepted by the town council, apparently, that this could serve as a turnaround, or perhaps that it is currently serving as a turnaround. It is not. Paper street directly on the other side of Stone Drive, identified as Stone Drive North, that is a functional turnaround right now, and it's not mentioned as being a turnaround. So I hope that this is just a clerical error where you've misidentified the turnaround as being south instead of north, as it should be, or if the town council, without letting me know, took action on the paper street abutting my house. The paper street next to my house, if that were to become a turnaround, it would be a nuisance because two of the three bedrooms of my house are something like 20 or 25 feet from that paper street. The paper street on the opposite side that is serving as a turnaround is abutted by a vacant lot, an unbuildable vacant lot on one side, and the large side yard of the other neighbor, which has plenty of barrier between the turnaround and his house. So I'd really like you to look into whether you made an error or whether you changed the game on me without letting me know. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jonathan Chang, 34 Mantor Street in Cape. I think the paper street U33-4 that would go from Mantor Street to Mitchell Street, we've been told that it was voted to be extended because there's some lots in the middle that could potentially be subdivided and need access. We were hoping to request that you would consider possibly vacating a portion of the paper street that went from, I guess it's U33-3, that portion of U33-4 from U33-3 down to Mantor Street, because if those lots were to be developed, the quickest egress to a major road would be Mitchell. And if all of U33-4 was developed, it would create a lot of traffic coming in from Mitchell to Mantor Street, which, you know, has a lot of kids riding bikes, a lot of kids in the neighborhood come there just because it's a quieter street, and it just doesn't seem like there would be a need for those lots to come into Mantor Street. They would need a way out to Mitchell. So that's what we were requesting.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, my name is Bob Cronin, 7 Avon Road, Cape Elizabeth. I've lived there 34 years. I border on the same paper street that Andy Bernstein borders on, catty corner from him. I have no objections to vacating it. I would like to speak in favor of the retention of, or an extension of Surfside Avenue and Atlantic Place. It's a beautiful area to walk down. It's a little bit overgrown now. It is part of my deed that I have a right to pass over this to the shoreline, but I would hate to, if it becomes vacated and people claim it, I would hate to have to fight the court costs of doing. Recently we had a dispute over Atlantic Way, and 27 residents of Cape Elizabeth fought the idea that it was vacated by the town, and the estimated legal bill is $14,000. And I would hate to have to keep on fighting for my right to pass over these Atlantic Way and Surfside Avenue. And if the town extends it, that would nullify the necessity of doing that. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Ann Cranshaw. My husband Doug and I live at Two Star Road and abut the paper street designated U21-2, Dearborn Road North. We wish to preserve the path on the parcel and take ownership of some or all of the land in order to rebuild a deck. We participated in the Brentwood neighborhood meeting as well as meetings of the Conservation Committee and the Planning Board. They both recommended vacating the parcel with an easement for the path. In July, you designated an accept status for the parcel, but noted that you're open to options. I will suggest two options, but would first like to give you some background information, and hopefully the map that went around will be helpful. When we purchased our home 26 years ago, there was a row of field stones running from the back survey pin to the front corner of the house, widening out into the paper street approximately 10 feet beyond our property line. It was suggested that the stones were arbitrarily placed there by the contractor who built the house. The area had been landscaped and maintained by the previous owners. We have continued that practice as well as maintaining the section of the path that is on the paper street. The house also had a small deck which has rotted. For years, we operated under the assumption that the Brentwood Association owned this particular piece of land and consulted several times on matters such as trees that threatened our home or users of the path. In July 2014, we received approval from the Zoning Board to build a new deck. The size and configuration of the deck is limited by the proximity of the house to the property line. Then we were unable to dig post holes deep enough to meet code due to roots from a large tree we had removed. I spoke with the association about buying that small piece of land that we had been taking care of up to that stone, row of stones, and that would have allowed us to move the post beyond the tree roots and build a larger deck. When I asked at the town hall about any impediments to such a transaction, it was discovered that the parcel was, in fact, a paper street that had not yet been added to the list. As a result, the association researched the issue themselves and agreed that they did not own the property. Two of the abutters also wish to preserve the path. They're the ones with the right-of-way between them, but have no interest in obtaining part of the parcel. The third is in back of us on Tall Pine Road. They have a 6-foot stockade fence that has effectively separated them from us, the neighborhood, and the path. So the two options that I propose are, first, to vacate the entire parcel. We would put a right-of-way into our deed. The second is to vacate approximately half of the parcel, bisecting it from the southeast corner to the northwest corner. Thank you.
Ooh, good timing.
I practiced a lot.
Thank you.
Good evening. Imad Khalidi, 19 Pilot Point Road, Cape Elizabeth. I'm here just to make sure that everybody on the town council reads the letter of the lawyer of the town, Mr. Leahy. It's July 3rd, and it's a very precise letter which explains to you what is a paper street and what are the costs of finding out what paper streets are. I'll just read, I think it's in your archives, and I think it's a public knowledge. It says clearly, it would appear that Attorney Steer's position that litigating this would be costly is correct. There are unsettled areas of law involved, and the fact finding might prove to be extensive. All I'm asking the town council is to make their homework, to do their homework on the legal part of it, as well as the mother land that we have that we don't like to disturb. You know, that area is a very nice area, and if we make it a public street for a Martian or an extraterrestrial or a Pennsylvanian to walk on it, I'm afraid that it would be more or less destroyed. Now, if my English is not clear, I can repeat if you wish to. My accent is not great. Thank you very much. All I'm asking is to reread the letter carefully. Do your homework. It's not an easy question. It's not just listening to people. It's more a legal issue of what a paper street is. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. My name is Joan Aldrich, and I live at 18 Lawson Road, where I've been for 23 years. And I just am speaking to support the town's retention of Woodcock Road. I'm sorry, I don't know the lot, the number. Does anybody? Woodcock Road is on Lawson Road. It provides a lovely scenic view to everyone in our neighborhood, and even residents who live on Shore Road, kind of around the corner from Lawson going towards Cape Elizabeth. Everybody walks on the street and enjoys the view. It is also part of the deeded rights of way that we have enjoyed. At the time of our subdivision in 1939, it was established as one of the rights of way. So we've already spoken about this, and we do bring the support of almost all of our neighbors, I believe. I don't even think the road's in contention, but I just wanted to thank you all for the thoughtfulness and time you've put into this matter and the opportunity for us to speak in support of your retaining it as a paper street. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Richard Armstrong from 2 Waverly Road. I have no requests, I just have a question. I grew up in New Jersey, I don't know anything about paper streets. Concrete, yes, but not paper. What does the term vacant mean?
Are you asking vacant or vacate?
Vacant, that's what it says, V-A-C-A-N-T. What does that mean?
Can you tell me what you're looking at specifically?
Yes.
Is it our document? Maureen, I'm going to ask you, because I can't see what he's looking at on that, but is it, are we really talking about vacating? Yes. So maybe it's a typo on there, or maybe it's very small print. I'm not sure because I don't have it in front of me, but I think we had the discussion about three options of extending the town's incipient rights in paper streets, vacating those rights completely, or extending the rights as state law allows for a 20-year period of time. Did I get that right?
Except, vacate, or extend.
All three. Did that make sense?
Yeah, what does vacate mean?
It means the town is giving up its rights, and I would defer to Maureen if she'd like to give a further explanation about how that actually transpires and how the land in that street is actually divided up. Would you like to respond to that question? Thank you.
Thank you. And for those of you who've heard this before, I'm sorry. But when a subdivision plan is recorded in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds, any streets that are shown on the plan.
Your time is not.
I'm okay to sit down. It's gone. So when a street is shown on a subdivision plan that's recorded in the Registry of Deeds, the act of recording the plan creates these rights that are out there that the town has the opportunity to accept. And when roads are actually built and they're in some fashion accepted by the town, those rights are accepted. But where the paper streets are not built, they only exist on paper. But there are these, as Councillor McCausland said, these incipient rights that are waiting for the town to accept, but if the town doesn't accept them, then they can expire and go away. Vacating is a legal decision by the town to explicitly say goodbye to those rights. We are permanently extinguishing our opportunity to accept those rights. For example, if the town were to vacate its rights in a street and 10 years later decided they really did need to build that street, they would have to treat that land as if it's just plain old ground. They'd have to purchase their rights. They'd have to recompensate whoever owned the property. So vacating is a termination of whatever legal rights the town has. Okay?
What does that mean to the homeowners?
Ah, that was the other part. So under state law, when you vacate a street, the property owners abutting the paper street get to divide that street up amongst themselves. So they take the paper street and to the center line, the people on one side get the land on one side, the people on the other side get the land on the other side. And there was someone who said, well, what if I don't want the land? And the answer was, well, it already is your land. I mean, actually, the example is, who owns the land under Route 77? And the answer that I got from an attorney is, it doesn't matter. because having Route 77 there is such a burden on the land, nobody else can do anything with it. So actually, the land that the paper street sits on is actually already owned by the abutters or reserved by the original subdivider, depending on how they recorded the subdivision. The town would not be responsible for making those adjustments. You would be obligated on your own to make those adjustments, although I am aware that the town assessor will make those adjustments to your property value. However, nobody has ever had a huge change in their property value because of assuming the land of a previously vacated street. Unless you have a lot that is not buildable and the additional land that you get from the paper street makes your land buildable, that would be a significant change of value. For most people, it's just, it's a small increment.
Maureen, if I could get back to the public hearing, and I would suggest, Mr. Armstrong, if you had more questions, that you might contact the town planner directly, and she'll be happy to answer them. Great. Thank you.
Good evening. Doug Monson, 3 Gladys Road, Cape Elizabeth. And my comments today, just regarding accepting some of these paper streets, is to try to reduce uncertainty in the process of doing that. And so I think Ms. Amira did a nice job making notes about what that land would be used for. And as a homeowner abutting some of these paper streets, knowing that that future use will be limited to those notes would be useful. The act of not knowing what that property can be used for in the future creates uncertainty, and of course that causes angst with property owners, because you have no idea what the town would use the land for. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Livia Jensen. I live on 71 Stony Brook Road. I'm looking at a paper street, U3-3B. And for the past 4 years, we moved here from Ohio. That paper street, we use it as a private driveway. We don't have a driveway or a garage. So now that the city come about to release it, we're asking if the city can just release that to us, so that we're looking to use our land and use the paper street as a setback so that we can build a garage on it. On the one side is my home, the other side just the paper street and then the wetland. So there won't be, I'm not looking to build anything past that. I'm just looking to use the paper street as a setback so that we can put a garage next to the house. That's pretty much it. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
So my name is Edward Fells at 4 Surfside Avenue, and I prepared a statement because my brain is tired. I'm a relative newcomer to the Shore Acres neighborhood, having purchased the property at 4 Surfside Avenue in June of this year. Like many of my neighbors, I was drawn to the unimpeded and majestic views of the ocean. In the limited time that I've owned the property, the Surfside Path has afforded me the opportunity to meet several neighbors passing by on leisurely walks. For anyone who might think otherwise, I want to make it clear that there is no intention to limit pedestrian access to Surfside Avenue. The access has been a historic precedent, it is deeded, and I have no desire to see it changed. Regarding Surfside Avenue's status as a paper street, I would like to know what the town gains from accepting it. Is the town willing and prepared to oversee the maintenance of the road? In its current incarnation, the residents of Surfside and Algonquin Extension are solely responsible for the upkeep of the road. This includes grading, snow removal, and cutting back overgrown brush, amongst other obligations. The Ocean View Association was established for this purpose. If Surfside Avenue is accepted by the town, I would expect the same benefits accorded to other streets, which would include proper road maintenance. If the intent of accepting Surfside is its future incorporation into the Greenbelt Trail Plan, I would like to clarify two important precepts. One, which I have already stated, is that the community already has deeded access to the walk, to walk the existing trail along Surfside Avenue and enjoy the views. The right is not under threat. Secondly, in the town council meeting from January 2014 regarding the Greenbelt plan, it was clearly stated on pages 17 and 18 that the Conservation Commission only works with willing property owners. In bold lettering, it also states, no eminent domain action has ever been used by the town to obtain land for open space. Does the town want to set an unusual and arguably negligent precedent by annexing private property, which already has deeded access for the community, for a less than quarter mile trail flanked by conventional paved neighborhood streets? For these reasons, I would support the town vacating rights to Surfside Avenue.
Thank you.
Mitchell Lynch from 15 Lighthouse Point Road. I don't recall the exact number of the paper street, but it abuts our house, and it's also next to the Two Lights Lighthouse. The paper road there, it's a very small strip of land. The issue we have, and I think pretty much every neighbor in our entire neighborhood has the same feeling, is we've been overrun with tourists coming into our neighborhood, parking, walking up on people's lawns. You may have heard this summer, the Caracases who owned the lighthouse keeper's house had someone take a car, set off explosives, light the car on fire to destroy evidence, and set their house on fire. We have fairly young kids. They have young kids. There's just too many people coming up into our neighborhood with the advent of GPS where people can locate. They think that there's some kind of access. So what they do is they park and they walk around until they get a better view. And it's unfortunately, there is no great place to get a very close view except up on people's property. So whether you live right where we do or you live a few houses away, it's become a big issue. And it's not about, the only reason I think potentially to hold on to that paper street is with the hope that someday the Coast Guard land, they'll create a path leading into our neighborhood, which would be a disaster for everybody who lives there. It would be, there's no good reason why you would need to ever, even if you ever did get access to that, to cut through into our neighborhood, which runs right next to our house. So we ask people to vacate that. We would ask you if you can vacate the land or at least come out to our neighborhood, come out on a weekend, especially at this time of year, see the amount of traffic that's coming through, how many people are coming into our area. So I just don't see a great purpose of retaining that land, and it would make everyone feel a lot more comfortable, including ourselves, if that land was vacated. I think in our neighborhood we'll get a bunch of comments in. We haven't organized that well lately, but I know a lot of people want to, and we can do that as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Bruce Dunphy. I live at 25 Algonquin Road. My property abuts Surfside Avenue and Algonquin Extension, the gravel roads in Shore Acres, not maintained by the town. One thing Ms. O'Mara forgot to mention is that there are cases in the state where the town has lost their rights of incipit dedication because they never took action on improved roads in the developments. Our road has been developed since the 30s, and the town has never, ever put anything into that road, to my knowledge, or anybody else that I have conversed with. In 1990, a law firm that represents Shore Acres Land Company's estate called me and asked me if we, the abutters of Surfside Avenue, would be interested in buying Surfside Avenue. And I said I'd have to check with the property owners of Surfside. And I got back to him and said, yes, we'd be interested in purchasing land. And we had a deeded right to purchase the land from that abuts Surfside Avenue to the ocean. At that time, I got a phone call from a Mr. Wooden, who was then the president of Shore Acres Improvement Association. Our association is called Ocean View Association, which is appropriate for where we live. And we came to an agreement to give anyone in Shore Acres who wanted an easement, a deeded easement, to walk and recreate over that land to the ocean. So over 70 families took advantage of that easement, and we gave them all a deeded easement. Now, to this day, I can stand here and say that no one in Shore Acres has ever been denied the right to walk on Surfside Avenue or walk to the ocean. And I can state that emphatically. Now, Surfside is a very complicated issue because our area is the only area that's ever been developed. You know, that's the only place that anybody's ever walked. To my knowledge, very few people, you know, some would stand here and say we've walked between Atlantic Place and Surfside, the paved part of Surfside Avenue, but few people have ever done it. And I challenge any of you ladies to ever go down there and try walking through there, okay? It just hasn't happened. So I'm asking the town to vacate this. And we've never denied anybody the right to walk. The town vacated Overlook in Shore Acres several years ago. There are several houses on there, just like there are on Art Street, that you can see Portland Headlight and the harbor. And they vacated. Why not vacate Surfside? Everyone in Shore Acres has a deeded right to walk, has a right to walk down on that area. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you for having me. My name is Sue Murray Garrett, a 54-year proud resident of Cape Elizabeth, here to talk about Surfside and Atlantic Place. Again, thank you to the councilors and town officials for your time and dedication to issues that are so controversial as these. As you know, I have shared my thoughts in the legalities for the past 4 years. So for new members, I'll just briefly update you. My request is to extend the paper street, and here's why it is not kicking the can down the road. By way of history, the Shore Acres community and the Cape Elizabeth community came together. The members worked passionately to go through the proper channels and successfully added the Surfside and Atlantic Place to the Greenbelt Plan. And the town committed to us, our rights would always be protected. An unscientific study shows that approximately 50 new homeowners on Pilot Point and about 50% change of ownership on Surfside over the past 10 years has occurred where this paper street lies. The importance of this is that those of us with a vested interest have to repeat the conversations in history over and over for new residents and new board members. We hope you hear us again. This is Cape Elizabeth property. Nothing has changed, nor has my story. My father, Jim Murray, sat where you sat in 1964 as a selectman. The town did not have $200,000. But he and the other selectmen at that time were visionaries and purchased Fort Williams. Now, other visionaries have created a park for children. My father did not purchase Fort Williams for himself because he actually preferred Kettle Cove. He purchased it for the community and for the community's children and now the community's grandchildren. Not only have we all had ball games there and graduations, but now a children's park. Who would have thought? Who would have thought a path on Shore Road would have been safe and collegial? No one ever living here 54 years would have believed that. We have great champions and great visionaries in this community. The paper street is a diamond in the rough. We as Shore Acres residents who have a separate deed, such as my husband Joe and I, are great stewards of this wonderful gift of nature. We actually have more young skateboarders coming down the hill in our front yard, slowing us down in and out of our house, than interruptions we have caused for our neighbors. We don't complain. We often cringe on the big spills, as if your kids were our own. always ready to help them. We do not spend inappropriate time in your front or backyards of any of our neighbors. We really are good stewards of this path. I ask again the council to be visionaries as the selectmen were in 1964, as the creators of the new Children Park just were, as the Shore Road Pathway Committee was, and as the Turf Committee was, just to mention a few. This is the single remaining waterfront ownership rights the town has.
If you could just finish up, that would be great.
Yeah, this belongs to all of us. We may not have a vision now. We may not have a vision later. We are neighbors, we are stewards, and respectful of everybody. It's please extend the rights. It is too great to lose. Thank you.
Thank you. And I didn't catch your address.
2 Katahdin Road, Shore Acres.
Thank you.
Claire Armstrong, 18 Avon Road in Shore Acres, though. So I too am urging you to extend the paper streets on Surfside and Atlantic Place. I think that the Shore Acres neighborhood is a complex neighborhood with many people having both deeded rights and rights that were set up when the subdivision was first created. I understand your desire to put this to bed, but I don't know about other subdivisions having specific rights awarded to the paper streets in those. But it has been a very controversial issue in our neighborhood. If you extend the rights for 20 years, perhaps it gives us time to sort it out, to see what direction the green belt is actually going to go in the next 20 years, and where trails might connect to other people's trails, other town trails. And I would actually like to make a correction to a previous speaker in that the Shore Acres Neighborhood Association has indeed maintained the gravel part of Surfside. But I don't want people to stop thinking about the Surfside Road as only the part where it's been developed as a road. It goes all the way along the ocean, and for Cape Elizabeth to lose the potential opportunity to have all citizens of Cape Elizabeth be able to enjoy that, I think would be a real loss. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Sheila Mayberry, 30 Trundy Road, Shore Acres. I've sent you a letter regarding my views supporting the extension of the town's rights over the entirety of the Paper Street, Surfside, and Atlantic Place. I want to point out some additional things. Especially, I want to highlight the town council's letter dated April 9th, 2013, wherein council chair Jim Walsh made it clear that the town would not extinguish its rights in Surfside. As many of you know, the council and the Conservation Commission worked tirelessly on this issue. The promise of the town council must be upheld. And I'm sure you can find that letter in the file. If you need a copy of the letter, if you can't find it, please let me know and I will email it to you. Any issue regarding the extension of the town's rights only to a portion of the paper street would undercut the hard work of many citizens and throw into question the credibility and reliability of the town's decision to add Surfside to the Greenbelt plan. I don't think that is the result any of us want. We have come too far and have worked too long together to do an about-face at this point. There are no additional issues that have arisen since the time the town council voted to accept the Conservation Commission's Greenbelt plan. The arguments of a few with vested personal interests in their shoreland vistas are the same they made 3 years ago and rejected by the town. Nothing has changed since then. I also want to make a point that not all residents in Shore Acres have deeded rights to Surfside Avenue. That is a mistake, in fact, that if you need to research that, you should. Finally, Surfside Avenue must be considered as a gift to the town and its residents, all residents. It was never meant to be vacated or divided. It was meant to allow the residents of Cape Elizabeth an opportunity to enjoy the shore and its awesome splendor. Before houses were built abutting the paper street, fields were there allowing unobstructed views. The lots that were sold there never included the paper street. It was always meant to be a continuing asset to the town and its residents. Now is not the time to extinguish that gift. Thank you.
Thank you.
If you need copies of the petition I also sent you today, I have them right here. Would anybody like them? There are over 400 names on that petition. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is John Perrin. I reside at 8 Surfside Avenue. And we respectfully request that the town council vacate the paper street project as it applies to Surfside Avenue. While Surfside Avenue is a private property, we residents have never, as Mr. Dunphy alluded to, never tried to prevent walkers, bikers, young families from using it. In the past, untrue statements have been made about us excluding people from using Surfside Avenue. The petition created and brought forth by the Shore Acres Improvement Association was made up of signatures gathered by making untrue statements to people, some of whom are not even residents of Cape Elizabeth. Please vacate this project. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jim Mora, 5 Wombeck Road. Surfside Avenue and Atlantic Place paper streets consist of ocean access points and about 2,000 feet or about a third of a mile on the ocean. Accepting these paper streets now or when the town is ready is in the best interest of the majority of the residents of Cape Elizabeth. I support accepting these paper streets as soon as the town is ready to provide public ways on these paper streets. There has been some talk about legal issues on Surfside Avenue and Atlantic Place paper streets. The town should make decisions on paper streets based on benefit to the majority of the residents of Cape Elizabeth and not on possible future legal issues. Legal issues may arise or not. Any legal issue may be easy to address or not. Issues that arise in the future during implementation of paper streets can be addressed when and if issues arrive, and implementation details can be modified at that time if needed. For today, paper street decisions should be made on the benefit to the majority of residents and not something that may or may not happen in the future. In summary, do what is in the best interest of the majority of residents of Cape Elizabeth and accept Surfside Avenue and Atlantic Place paper streets when you are ready to add a paper way. And act on paper street right-of-ways, act on paper street public ways in a timely manner. Thank you.
Thank you.
If I could just encourage people to line up, if you would.
I wanted to be the last one, though.
I'm
Catherine Adams. I live at 15 Spoondrift Lane. I just am requesting that you vacate U-12-5 Surfside Ave, as well as U-36 1 and 2 Spoondrift. That was tabled, but I'm not certain actually what that fully means, even though we went through that earlier. I've lived here for over 30 years, and almost all that time has been in Shore Acres. I grew up on Surfside Ave, and now live on Spoondrift Lane in Broad Cove. My husband and I both went to high school here. Actually, he went to elementary school. I've had the honor to help plan our town's 250th anniversary. I have now served on two boards in our town. I love this town. I'm extremely proud to live in Cape Elizabeth. I have three children, and I want them to continue to enjoy Cape Elizabeth. I'm shocked, I'm saddened by the ugliness that this paper street controversy has brought forth in our community. It has forced people to move away from our town. It has divided our community, and many people may not know that. Our town is now looking to take land owned by a private tax-paying citizen to leverage the paper streets at U-12-5. This is just needs to end. Please, I strongly urge you to vacate U-12-5 and U-36-1 and 2. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Lisa Manila, and we own at 9 Beach Bluff Terrace, and I'm here to talk about the Thompson Paper Road. Beach Bluff Terrace is a dead-end street in Cape Elizabeth with something that I would consider more modest homes for Cape Elizabeth. And a few years ago, I've lost track, 6 or 7 years ago, a house was allowed to be built on Thompson Road by the Nickersons. When this was allowed, we came to a meeting here and were told that we should divide the paper road between our two properties and that trees should be planted in the middle. So the Nickersons, when they built this house, were actually required to do that. So at that time, we thought the paper road would not continue any further. excuse me, I wish I had notes or had written this up in advance. We live a reasonable distance from Beach Bluff Terrace at 9 Beach Bluff Terrace. If this paper road is continued, it will be widened and it will be in our backyard about the distance from where I am right now to this wall. So our home will be on both sides will have streets. And I just don't know if there's a precedent in Cape Elizabeth for anyone living with streets in this rural community on both sides of their home. If this happens to us, it will also happen to at least five neighbors on the street whose homes will be surrounded by road on both sides with traffic and headlights, the light and noise pollution that comes with that. A gentleman who spoke previously mentioned that the paper roads should benefit the majority and not the minority. And extending this paper road would only benefit the owners of the land down the paper road who would like to access it, which I understand they'd like to access their land, but they could also access their land through their own driveway. And it would not affect the values and the enjoyment that the other five neighbors have of their homes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm Heather Geike. I live at 12 Surfside Avenue. First of all, thank you so much for letting us, or listening to our comments this evening. I just wanted to bring up something from the meeting in February, and there was a question asked of the council, and it was deferred to Ms. O'Meara, and she responded that, and I'm quoting from the notes from the town on the website, Ms. O'Meara said that the town takes a long view on connectivity, working with willing property owners, just here, I need some glasses here, to put pieces in place over time. So the one thing I wanted to just bring up was that takes a long view on connectivity. There is no connectivity on U-12-5 Surfside Avenue. It goes out to Pilot Point, which is a public street, and it goes out towards Algonquin. Algonquin Extension is a paper street, excuse me, it is a private road, and there's just no connecting of any trails in the Greenbelt system. The other thing I would like to bring up is that she said she was working with willing property owners. Well, Ocean View Associates does own the property from our land all the way to the ocean, and we are not willingly going to give up this property. The second thing I wanted to bring up was that the lawyer, Durwood Parkinson, which is the town lawyer, he said that he would not comment on private rights, but if the town is using a paper street, it should accept its rights. The town does not and never has used Surfside Avenue. So why would you accept it? I would like to just make a comment on someone else's comment about the deeds and that some people do not have deeded access to walk. We have people from Broad Cove, from People's Cove, and from all over Shore Acres that come and use the path. They walk. It's never been an issue, and we've never stopped anybody, and we do not plan to stop anybody from using it for walking, biking, bringing their kids down on the strollers. So whether it's deeded or not. The other issue is the parking. I just don't know where we'd park all these people if you open it up to the Greenbelt, where we have people from California or Missouri or wherever coming in. Waben Street is not even a street. It's literally wide enough to fit a snowplow. And that would be a street that would, it's almost adjacent, to Surfside Avenue. So these are just some issues that I would like you to think about. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Aaron Anker. I have lived in Cape Elizabeth for 12 and a half years at 5 Algonquin Road in Shore Acres. I'm a couple blocks off the ocean and about a quarter mile down to Surfside Road. I'm talking about U12-8 and U12-5. I do have deeded rights to the ocean, and I've used it quite a bit, unencumbered, as it's been mentioned so far. Before I speak, I know it's likely obvious there are many people here who have perspectives that live on the water or folks that have been working on developing paths, and I understand both those, but I'd like today to talk from my perspective, which is as a father with two kids in the Cape School, as a Shore Acre resident of 12 and a half years, a business owner, and a Cape resident. So please hear this perspective. I've walked on Surfside Road many thousand times. I've played in the ocean there with my kids. We go to Trundy Beach, which is just maybe a half mile further walk. And for the first 7 years of the 12 and a half years, I lived in a neighborhood that was very copacetic. It was wonderful. There were no sides. We had Christmas parties, we sang carols, we held lobster bakes, we found Easter eggs together. Then it changed. There were disputes. How it changed, we could argue about house heights, decks and paper streets, the town potentially not managing things properly, the neighborhood kind of going wild, wild west, just the best way to put it. People just kind of taking sides. It's happened. And it's been really sad. I can tell you, I still have lovely friends there, and I just don't talk about this anymore with people because it's just not a fun topic. But I really fear what's going to happen if you guys activate either of these streets, because it's a very contentious issue. You can hear it today. People are calm, but when they're not sitting in front of a bunch of people, people are whispering in the background. It's just not fun. And I'm not bringing this up to bring up old pain, but I think you need to think about it, because as town managers, as council people, it does affect a neighborhood, a major neighborhood, with something that's already been used very, very easily. And I don't know that it adds that much value. What I will say, as a town resident, I feel I have more than enough paths and gorgeous views in this town. Fort Williams, Robinson Woods, Gullcrest. It's why I live here. I love that. As a father, I'm more disappointed for my kids that they don't have this kind neighbor that they once had. I don't want it to go backwards. I'd like it to just go forward. I'd prefer our time use its time and money to educate our children. I think everybody would. As a business owner, I like to plan before I do things. I look at this path, and I fear there are too many things not planned. Access to the path from Atlantic Place seems like it goes through a driveway. I prefer that the town would mediate the sides. I've only got one more thing. And I think that this could be done. So I think a couple of people have said extend it, and that's where I'm at. I think extending it allows you to study it longer, get potential buy-in. Maybe there's a mediation here. I've been at mediations. Mediations are a fascinating thing, and I'd like to see the town do that. So I suggest that you extend and not activate. So thank you for listening to me. I just want to say one other thing, just because Heather mentioned it. As somebody who does walk down there without parking, and people drive way too fast down Algonquin already, and skateboarders, which was also mentioned, when people are coming into our neighborhood who are not familiar with our neighborhood, they don't slow down, right? I always remind the kids that get their driver's license, I've done it to about 5 kids, hey, I was that kid at 16, slow down, especially when the road was resurfaced. I just would say that's another thing to consider. So
thank you.
Good evening. My name is Eric Kruger. I live at 33 Beach Bluff Terrace with my wife, Maureen, who's not with me tonight, helping kids through her homework. Discussion topic is U10-1 Thompson Road. Many of my wonderful neighbors are here. I'm a lifelong Cape Elizabeth resident, been on Beach Bluff Terrace for 20 years. Several years ago, we had the opportunity to buy 11 slices of land behind Beach Bluff, a budding Thompson Road. And we took that opportunity, and the land is in trust for my two sons, a 10-year-old and a 13-year-old. As I grew up in this town, I'd like them to have the opportunity to raise their children in this town. The development along Thompson Road has been very tasteful, no complaints on our end. Recommendation from the council workshop to the town council to maintain its rights in Thompson Road to our property line so that we can access the land that we bought over the years. I don't think it's the town's intent to cut us off from our own land. We looked at the opportunity of extending our driveway, but there are easement issues with our neighbors, and we'd also have to build the road over our septic system, which, as you can all imagine, is a very expensive option. The other option is to tear my house down so the kids can get to their land, and that wasn't in the plan either. So we ask that this compromise position of allowing us to the town to maintain its rights so we could access the land that we bought, and then after our land, the recommendation, which we think is a fair compromise, is to for the town to abandon its rights after our property. And I ask that the town council, you know, seriously consider that recommendation for approval. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Clara Cohen. I live at 15 Beach Bluff Terrace, and Thompson Road is the paper street that is between, as Lisa Manella and Eric had just stated. And so we do have a concern if that street is extended down to Eric's property. We've already, it's very disrupted to live with lights, light pollution that happens because of where the Nickersons ended up purchasing their home. And that light pollution would continue if that street goes behind our house even further and to access the land that Eric has. I guess what I'm really asking is it would be really wonderful to be able that the town work with Eric in terms of making his new piece of land accessible via their property, whether it's variance, whatever. And, you know, the cost of moving a septic field and such is probably a lot less than building that road. And I don't know if I believe that he would be responsible for the cost of building that road through some areas that actually are also wetland areas. But to really look at all the different options so that Eric Kruger can have access to his land, but perhaps not by using Thompson Road. So I would really like to suggest vacating Thompson Road. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, I'm Ogden Williams, and I live at 5 Beach Bluff Terrace. We've lived there for 25 years. This is another property impacted by the Thompson Road idea. First of all, thank you for what you do, and thank you for this opportunity. So the first 20 years, Thompson Road runs, abuts the length of our property. For the first 20 years when we lived there, there was a nice sort of thicket of various wild lilacs and so on that provided us a nice barrier, a sense of privacy. And then 5 or 6 years ago, the Nickerson's home was built, and those trees were all cut down, and so the part of Thompson Road that we're living on now is a driveway, And so a very nice bunch of trees were planted there so that we would be able to have some kind of privacy. This is about 5 years ago. And I have taken such good care of those little trees. I fertilized them and watered them and loving, just as they grow slowly. And now they are, it's a nice barrier. I mean, basically, we're not looking at the driveway. Unfortunately, if this driveway becomes a road in order to access another house, it's odd to me that accessing one more house turns a driveway into a road. But at that point, as I understand it, the road needs to be widened substantially. And all the best information I have is that all of these trees are going to be cut down again and will start all over again. And if that happens, that will be a dreary day for the Williams family. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, good evening. My name is Russ Keenan, and I live at 3 Spoondrift Lane. And really was here tonight to try to clarify something and to ask some questions, and just to point out that we own a small parcel of land that runs adjacent to our house at 3 Spoondrift. It's approximately 150 feet long, and that's called U36-1. And this is not a paper street. On the subdivision plan, it shows it as a private way. This was confirmed by the town attorney, and you could look at the August 11th town council project status report that Maureen prepared. So this parcel is actually part of our warranty deed, for which we've been taxed for 25 years on it. So I just wanted to confirm that this private way is going to be removed from the paper street list, and I would urge that you do that.
I believe it already has been removed from that list. Is that correct, yeah. Maureen?
In the drafts, it's proposed to not be considered a paper street, and it reverts to its private way status.
Okay, because I saw a couple places it was listed as tabled and that. And I would also support my neighbor's position on U36-2, because I understand that's a similar situation as well off of Spoondrift. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Deborah Casey. I live at 28 Algonquin Road, sometimes referred to as Algonquin Extension, which when you proceed east or northeast down the road, it hooks and then becomes Surfside. Surfside continues around and eventually gets to Pilot Point Road. So we live right on the corner as you come around from Algonquin Extension. It seems like there are several issues, because the paper road on Pilot Point that is in front of the homes that are there, between the homes and the ocean, is Surfside Ave, but it's different from the Surfside Ave that has been maintained by Ocean View Associates that is used now for walking and biking and whatnot. Algonquin Extension is a private way. It is not considered a paper street, I believe. My concern is kind of on what Ed said earlier, that aside from the lack of connectivity right now, if the town decided to take Algonquin Extension to provide a link for any kind of trail that would end up happening on the rocks, they would essentially be having to take by eminent domain a private road. I don't believe this has been done at this point yet in order to work on the greenbelt. If that happens, then you're, as Ed said, there's going to be a pretty negative precedent set, and you're going to have a lot of people who live either on the ocean side or inland who have a private way, a private road, whatever you might want to call it, all the way down Shore Road onto the east side towards the ocean is primarily private roads. So if you're trying to make a connection, you're going to be talking, having people that are pretty upset, I think, because there are going to be a lot of people on private roads who will be impacted by it. I also want to address the issue that has come up again and again about rights to Algonquin. If it's not in your deed, we will add it to your deed. But regardless of whether it's in your deed or not, no one on our road has ever stopped anyone and said, is this in your deed to come down here? We have people from every neighborhood in Cape Elizabeth. No one cares. Everyone is respectful. They come down on the beach, they fish, they swim, they whatever. And it bothers me a lot that people keep wanting to bring up this idea that they're gonna lose their rights to the road. No one's gonna lose their right to do what they've always done. We've had people from out of state come down. Unfortunately, our particular property goes down to the low water mark. Right now, I don't care who goes in the water. But if it becomes a green belt, I don't want the public down on the part of the beach that was always used by the people in the neighborhood. And I'd have to put a sign up saying, sorry, this is not part of the green belt. You can't come on the beach anymore. I don't really want to do that, but that's what's going to happen if you basically take what's a green belt already for the people in Cape Elizabeth Shore Acres and try to make it official green belt. So thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Bill Nickerson and live at 3 Thompson Road. Since we've been brought up 3 times, I thought I ought to show my face. I wrote a letter today, and I did it because this gets fairly technical in terms of the distances between the houses, Lisa's and Hans and Clara's. So I thought I'd put it in writing so you could take a look at it and look at it again if you needed to. But just to clarify, the plan for the lot that we bought was approved in May of 2007. And the plan required us as buyers, we bought the lot in 2009, it required 27 shrubs and trees to be planted within the boundary, within the bounds of Thompson Road. So it was basically in the middle of the street. At the time, we talked with the code enforcement officer who said we could add additional trees within the Thompson Road boundaries to create further privacy. And we've done that, Ogden's done that. So now there are over 40 trees that are located within Thompson Road. And these are now pretty mature trees. They've been planted for 6 years. And they provide nice privacy. There's a section of fence that we put in to provide some additional privacy between the end of one group of trees and the beginning of another group of trees. So to have that road developed would create, and I'm glad that others have spoken tonight, but would create certainly a hardship for us. The front of our house would then be 30 feet from the boundary of the road. And when we decided to make the purchase of the lot, a lot of it was predicated on the fact that the planning board had dictated that the trees would be planted in the road. If they had to be planted on our boundaries, then we'd have less than 30 feet to the boundary of the road, and we certainly wouldn't have bought the lot. And beyond that, we're not looking to have traffic. None of us wants traffic. But so I would just emphasize what others have said and urge that the road be vacated. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Hilda Khalidi, 19 Pilot Point Road. I promise my accent is better than my husband's, so I will be very brief, as I believe much of what has been said and what will be said this evening has been so over the last 3 or 4 years. At conservation meetings, town hall meetings, and the proposed path is still this contentious paper street left all this time. I don't know why. The cliffs in my backyard are still dangerous. The drop is still the same. The liability factors remain the same. The cost and logistics of installing a path remain the same. The only thing that has not remained the same is a nice, peaceful, quiet neighborhood. This has, it's just pitted neighbors against neighbors. People don't really wave to each other anymore, cars passing like we used to. And I just ask each member of the town council to imagine this is your house, and it's your backyard, it's your living space, and you have strangers walking this distance, looking in your windows. Imagine if it was you. And one other thing I want to say, if it became public and part of any sort of a green belt, imagine somebody from Minnesota staying at the Inn by the Sea, gets a map, and says, oh, this looks really beautiful. And they walk and find themselves with their small children in my backyard, where I have a swimming pool, and I have Europeans that love to sunbathe topless. I'd be mortified and horrified that a town had sent me to this place. So I request that the town vacate this paper street. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Hello. My name is Andrea Adams, and I'm at 25 Algonquin Extension in Shore Acres. I'm one of the homeowners who own the 1,200 feet of the gravel portion that's being discussed tonight. I have several questions that I want to ask. Can the town council guarantee that the Public Works Department will maintain, plow, and resurface Surfside and Algonquin Street Extension if you decide to take it from us? We homeowners have spent thousands of dollars on this work over the past decades. Will the town council guarantee that no cars will drive these private roads in the future if you make it a green belt? Many, many children already use our roads, and they run up and down the roads all summer long. Can you tell us what will be the cost to the town if you turn our private road into a green belt trail? What are the legal ramifications if you take our privately owned road? Shore Acres has Trundy Point. It's 3/10 of a mile from Surfside Ave. It's nearly 6+ acres of prime oceanfront land with a sandy beach and a long walking trail out to the point and back. It was donated to the Land Trust years ago for all Cape Elizabeth residents to use. The Greenbelt Plan marks Shore Acres as an underserved neighborhood. To qualify as described by the plan, I quote, "This category includes trail expansion in neighborhoods with little or no trail system within a comfortable walking distance." I think 3/10 acre from my house, which was where Trundy Point is a comfortable walking distance. So I don't understand why we've been labeled as an undeserved neighborhood. I think we have more land available in our little tiny neighborhood of Shore Acres than most other areas in Cape. I've spoken to several realtors, one of whom actually spoke with an appraiser. I have been assured that if the town takes over our oceanfront private roads by eminent domain or any other such other means, that our property values will absolutely diminish. One last item, and this is really sad. This morning, while walking through the neighborhood, which I do every morning, I was approached by a homeowner who wanted to come tonight and speak out in support of keeping Surfside and Algonquin Extension private. She did not want it to become part of the Greenbelt because of the added business and traffic and people and walkers and cars that it'll bring into our little tiny neighborhood, which only has one entrance into it. We don't have an emergency exit access, nothing. We just have one little tiny uphill road into our neighborhood. She's not here tonight. She told me this morning that she feared the negative reactions from some of the neighborhood people who don't agree with her feelings, that it would be detrimental to her and her children. So she didn't want to show up. Isn't that disgusting? I don't understand why anyone in Shore Acres would want the general public coming into our small neighborhood if you make it a green belt path. We've already got plenty of beautiful areas. Thank you.
Thank you. If I could just ask if there's anyone else who would like to speak, please come up to the podium and form a line. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Deborah Murphy, and I live at 24 Pilot Point Road. And I actually wasn't planning on speaking tonight because you've heard from me and I've been at town council workshops, but after I'm hearing a lot of what is being said, I just need to say that when I moved into Shore Acres, we moved there because I was driving around and we were looking for a property in Shore Acres, and people waved and it was great. And I thought, wow, what a nice neighborhood. And it still is a really nice neighborhood. I moved in, and my neighbor, Bessie Burkett, who is no longer with us, and two other neighbors, Albert DeMillo, across the street from me, and Barbara Ely, educated me on Surfside Avenue and the right-of-way, because from 1963 forward in the Shore Acres Improvement Association notes, I'm the president of Shore Acres Improvement Association now, the reason that Shore Acres Improvement Association started was because folks that lived near the water and abutted the paper street, it just was a contention, the use of it. So it seems to like cycle every 10 or 20 years, but the rights are there. And I guess I would say that the gentleman that developed Shore Acres, C. Hall Baker, was a great guy. I think I wish I could have met him. He developed it with the thought, Surfside Avenue, for the public that doesn't know, Surfside Avenue is not a street with two parallel lines. It's a big tract of land. And the thought was that every lot on the 1911 subdivision plan would have access to the ocean. And there was no exclusivity to the ocean for those that abutted the paper street, Surfside Avenue, which also includes Atlantic Place. So I want to share it with the people of Cape Elizabeth. I do have express language in my deed. And the 70 people that Mr. Dunphy mentioned that had a confirmatory deed that was actually done by Shore Acres Improvement Association when we found out that Mr. Dunphy and company were trying to buy the underlying fee, and Ed McCall, a neighbor, wanted to be sure that there was a confirmatory deed added to make sure that the rights weren't lost, but that deed laid on top of your existing deed and you didn't lose any existing rights. So the rights go all the way back to as far as 1902, actually, before the 1911 plan came out and forward. I feel that the trail would be a beautiful trail. There can't be very many greenbelt trails on the Atlantic Ocean. Ocean access is disappearing all over the United States, and I think it would be a really great addition, so I vote to have it extended. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
My name is David Roberts. I live at 25 Trundy Road, Cape Elizabeth. I grew up in Cape Elizabeth. I've lived in Cape Elizabeth since 1966. I grew up in Broad Cove. As a kid, we used to travel Surfside all the time, never had any problems with any of the neighbors, going in and out. I had friends that had tree forts on Surfside. You know, it was the best view in Cape Elizabeth that's had. I'm just afraid if the town abandons the right-of-way to this Surfside, then the abutters will try to take it over. And at this time, I just don't think that is the right way to go. I agree with Debbie Casey, that we've never had a problem walking Surfside on the other part, but as far as the part that is doesn't really have a path to it, you know, I believe that there should be a path to join that path for the people of Cape Elizabeth to use. I think it would be a shame if everyone couldn't enjoy that path. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Chuck Rizzuco. I live at 6 Wambach Road in Shore Acres. And boy, I don't envy you people at all. I mean, the position you're in to, as representatives of the town of the Cape Elizabeth, it's, I don't know what's, I mean, if I ever wanted to feel like what it's like to be beat by a rubber hose incessantly, I would run for town council. I mean, what I'm hearing is a lot of reality is very individualistic. We all build our own reality, and we all speak from that position of what we think the reality is. And so I think a lot of what I've heard here is based upon people's building of what that reality is from their perspective. And obviously there's a lot of differences of opinion. But what I haven't heard is speaking from a point of quality of life. Where is the improvement to build a better quality of life for Cape Elizabeth residents? I think the town council is before you. Hopefully the town council is yet to come, will carry this vision of what for the town can we do, one, to preserve the values that we have as a town, and two, what can we do to increase that value or increase the quality of our quality of life here in Cape Elizabeth. Me personally, I think the Surfside Atlantic Place, I think we should extend or accept that. But I think the higher order here to look at is to trust you with the ability to make that decision of what's best for the collective of a town that has a beautiful resource like the ocean, and to be able to make the right decision that moves us from where we are to quality of life to a higher plane. And please consider that in your when you're considering the issues, not just for Surfside, but also for the other paper streets in town. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? No? Last chance. Step right up.
Good evening. I'm Maria Rinaldi. I'm the owner of 4 Atlantic Place. I wasn't going to speak tonight, but after that last comment about quality of life, I thought I'd come up and give you a perspective that maybe hasn't been heard yet. A lot has been said, and the same points have been repeated months after months here. But what hasn't been heard is from the family perspective. My family, my husband, Carmen, and I purchased the house. We're the third owners at Atlantic Place. We're raising our three sons there. We have had the great fortune of moving into this neighborhood from a lot of perspectives. There are many families in this neighborhood. On Pilot Point alone, there are 14 children. We all use the bus system for Pond Cove. And when we get off the bus, all the moms come out into the road to make sure the children are safe because they ride their bikes up and down Pilot Point. And one of the things my husband and I love the most about our property is that it's become kind of a central point for the children. We have our driveway, if anyone has seen it, is awesome for bike riding and three-wheelers and skateboards and everything. There's like a really nice slope and a long path down. So they'll start up at Pilot Point and come down, and we'll have a mom at the bottom and a mom at the top. But the problem with Atlantic Place is that it uses our private driveway, but it also cuts through the shrubbery. The shrubbery and our driveway is where all the children play. They run from our house to the other houses. And the moms and I text back and forth, and we say, okay, left, do you have him? And it's this great community feeling. It's this great system. And I just read the book, I Got Here As Soon As I Could. And it's written by a woman that moved from Florida to Maine. And she talks about she wished she had figured out the Maine way of life sooner for her children. And that is the best thing about living in Cape Elizabeth, that our children have what our parents had in the 50s. I let my children run, and my neighbors let their children run, and we enjoy this. But this path has taken that away from us. This feeling of animosity, this feeling of hatred, it makes us uncomfortable. And if we had a green belt trail that cut through there, and I knew people outside of the neighborhood had access to this land right next to my garage, I would be very uncomfortable, and it would make my husband and I just reconsider our future plans here in Cape Elizabeth. And I think it would for many other people in our neighborhood, because that's not why we're here. It's just ruining the sense of safety, the sense of community, the sense of shared parenting. My husband and I would never, ever try to prevent someone to have access to water views or the ocean. We really support we support everything about the Greenbelt trails. We use them frequently, and that is not what we're about. What we're about is using the Greenbelt Trails in a way to support families and support our community. And I don't feel like passing Atlantic Place and the Surfside Road is in support of that mission at all. So I'd ask you to vacate this. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Joe Garrett, Tukatadden Road. I just want to correct the record. I was past president for a couple of years for the Shore Acres Association. And our association pays fees yearly, and that's basically to maintain Surfside. So I feel that the Shore Acres Association has maintained the road in the past, and I just wanted to share that with everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Stuart Wooden. My wife's name is Julie. We live at 33 Pilot Point Road. We're right in the middle between the gravel road and the undeveloped portion. And just a couple of things. One is that I used to be the treasurer of the Shore Acres Association, and yes, it is for improvements for the road, and it is to pay for litigation against the people that are along Surfside Avenue. So it's not all to improve the road. The other thing is that I would definitely agree with Aaron Anker and some of the others that said how contentious this has gotten to be. I mean, he doesn't even live on Pilot Point, and he could imagine what it's like on Pilot Point when you don't look people in the eyes anymore, you don't wave, you might turn around and go the other way. Holiday parties, you get disinvited. I mean, it's really an ugly place. And to keep this uncertainty going makes it worse. It's just going to continue. More legal fees are going to be spent, and you shouldn't make a decision on just legal, but that's what it's like over there. It's legal fees, not getting along with your neighbor, not doing the right thing. It's just not good, and for people that live here, we've got a cloud over our head all the time, and people are trying to move and sell their houses, as the brokers are saying, wait a minute, you're going to have to take a big discount. All of this uncertainty is just perpetuating what's going on in the neighborhood. So, like I wrote to you before, I hope you vacate this Surfside Avenue. Thank you.
Thank you.
Richard Lemieux at 10 Waving Road in Cape Elizabeth. Just a couple comments. For me, it's a matter of fairness. I don't live on the water. But this paper street has been in existence over 100 years. And not until maybe 3 years ago, this has been brought up and a few people want it developed. And I just find that very difficult to accept because I've been in the neighborhood since 85. And from 85 to 2010, not a word was talked about that's turning that into a paper, turning the paper street into a pedestrian walkway. The other thing is that those streets that border the water, they were there because they were double lots. You needed to have that paper street there to access that second lot on the water. All those lots along Pilot Point Road were bought as single lots. Made the street, you know, it wasn't required. And I do think it's going to cost the town one hell of a lot of money to develop anything on that, along those cliffs. My comments. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Carol Leopold. I live at 25 Pilot Point Road. I'm distressed that I just heard an "ah, my God" as I walked up here. Like, I don't have a right to speak. I did not want to speak. I don't want to take up any more of your time. I don't want to take any more years of the town council's time. I'm just struck by the comments here tonight, mostly about people with other paper streets, not just the Shore Acres paper street. And all of those concerns are people that abut that street. It strikes me that the town needs are what should be considered, and the abutters' needs should be considered here. I think Shore Acres is the only place that the non-abutters' desires are the principal source of agitation for all of these years. I would just urge you to simplify, get to the basics. What is a paper street? It is a road that appeared on paper but was never built over 100 years ago. A developer in Shore Acres thought they might want a road. No one has needed it for 100 years. On my section of the paper street, there's a fenced-in vegetable garden. It's been there since at least 1977. The rest is shrubbery. And it seems that the questions before you should be the same as they were for any other paper street that you considered. Does the town need it? Has the town been using it? Your town employee mentioned that maybe the town would be like, oh, what if we do want to build on it? This is not a buildable road. It's not a road that you need emergency access. I think if these questions were easy for the other paper streets, I would just urge you to let them be easy for Shore Acres as well. Think of the critical needs of the town with respect to paper streets and the legislative and judicial suggestions on how to handle paper streets, the advice of your council, and you now have the opportunity to end this and give people some peace in their homes. And I'd urge you to do that and consider consider that you're setting policy here. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Maynard Murphy. I live at 24 Pilot Point Road in Shore Acres. Atlantic Place and Surfside Paper Streets are between some properties on Pilot Point Road and the ocean, and was put in place with the original development of Shore Acres neighborhood as delineated on the 1911 subdivision plan. Some properties in Shore Acres, mine included, have expressly deeded rights on Surfside Avenue, and others have implied rights. The town has incipient rights. As many of us know, the Surfside and Atlantic Place paper street and in its entirety would be one of the most scenic portions of the Greenbelt Trail system in town. I therefore implore the town to accept or at least extend the entire length of Surfside and Atlantic Place. It would be a tremendous asset to the Greenbelt Trail system in town. So please extend or accept Surfside Avenue and Atlantic Place for the greater good of the citizens of our town. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Seeing no one else, I'm going to close the public hearing at this point. Thank you for all of your comments. Public hearing is closed. And excuse me. Council is still in session, so if you would all like to talk further, we have a long agenda still to get through tonight. If you'd like to continue your conversations outside of here, that would be great. Thank you. We do appreciate your moving out of the room so we can continue with our meeting. Thank you. Yes. Caitlin.
I move that we table this until our October 5th meeting.
We are moving on to item number 110, and Caitlin has moved that we table this until our October 5th meeting of the council. Do we have a second on that? Patty, thank you. Discussion?
Not debatable.
Oh, sorry, not debatable. Oh, thank you. All in favor? That is unanimous. Thank you. We will move on to item number 111, the Comprehensive Planning Committee. Michael, will you give us the introduction to this item?
Yes, the town council, as one of its goals, agreed earlier in the year that they wish to have a comprehensive planning committee. A draft charge was prepared for the committee that would start meeting in early 2017. The draft charge was reviewed at a council workshop recently, and it's now before the council for formal action.
Thank you. Do we have a motion on this item? Patty?
I move that we approve the draft charge and a budget of $55,000 for the Comprehensive Planning Committee.
To begin meeting in early 2017?
And begin meeting in early 2017. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have a second on that? Thank you, Sarah. Discussion on that? No? All in favor? Any opposed? No? That is unanimous. We will move on to item number 112, Thomas Memorial Library Foundation bylaws. Michael, again, would you introduce that?
Thank you. At the last council meeting, the town council approved changes in names of various boards and commissions. A couple of those involved the Thomas Memorial Library. What was once known as the trustees is now the Thomas Memorial Library Committee. So it has an impact on the bylaws of the Thomas Memorial Library Foundation Group. So it's recommended that you request the Thomas Memorial Library Foundation to provide that nominees who are now to be nominated by the trustees instead be appointed by the Thomas Memorial Library Committee, which is because the trustees are the council, and you really, my understanding, you prefer the Library Committee to do that. And it's also recommended that in lieu of two trustees serving on the Foundation Board, that it be two members of the Thomas Memorial Library Committee.
Thank you. Do we have a motion on that? Jessica?
I so move.
Thank you. Second?
Jamie.
Thank you, Jamie. Discussion on that? No? Nope. All in favor? Any opposed? No? That passes unanimously. We will move on to item number 113, which I believe needs to be a public hearing. I will just open the public hearing on this item. This is on the annual general assistance update. And Deb, were you going to speak to that, or Michael, are you introducing that item?
Do you want to, or do you want me to?
Sure, I can do that. No. Thank you very much. Each year, MMA provides for the town different maximums. These are appendices to the general assistance ordinance, and you have in your packet the recommended maximums beginning October 1st, 2016 through September 30th, 2017.
Thank you. Any members of the public who would like to speak on this issue? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing. Do we have a motion on this item? Yes, Sarah.
I move that we adopt the annual updates to the general assistance updates.
Thank you. Is there a second?
From the Maine Municipal Association.
Second.
Caitlin, thank you. Discussion on that? Anyone have any questions? No? All in favor? Any opposed? Passes unanimously. Our next item is number 114, the technical amendments. Caitlin, would you give us a quick introduction on that?
Yes, the ordinance committee met and we reviewed a whole menagerie of items that, as to be referred to as the technical amendments, a laundry list of things that the planning board and other staff have been finding that needed to be updated in the ordinances. And we reviewed them and found that no changes need to be made to what was suggested, and have moved it to the council to put for a public hearing.
I'm sorry, did you make a motion that...
I recommend that we send it to a public hearing for the October 5th meeting.
Thank you. Do we have a second on that, Jessica?
I'll second.
Thank you. Any discussion on that item?
Public comment.
I'm sorry, what?
Anybody want to comment on...
Oh. Is there anyone who would like to comment on that item? No? Yes, Sarah, did you want to say something?
Just a quick question. Jay Cox emailed us. I'm not sure if people got his email or not. I don't think the council got it. But anyway, I talked to him very briefly before the meeting, and he did have a good point about the small section having to do with changes in the short-term rentals to try to address all the Airbnb rentals, but not discount other potential uses. So my only question is, will he have time to explain that to us, and will we have time to incorporate or at least discuss his suggestions before or after the public hearing?
Or do we plan to vote right after the public hearing?
Caitlin?
Yes, I think I've also spoken with Jay, and we are going to try and work with the code enforcement officer and Maureen over the course of the next month to see if any changes or any new language or whatever can be made. And then it was also suggested that if something else further needs to be addressed to that section of the technical amendments, we can separate that one item out of the technical amendments and pass all the others that may be very nicely necessary, that we could get those passed in a timely manner and continue to work on this if necessary.
And we'll have that information prior to our next meeting?
Yes.
Jessica?
Yes, could I ask, Chairman, will the Ordinance Committee be looking at this? This is news to this member.
This was just an item that was emailed to everybody that Jay Cox... No, well, sorry, was sent to... We got it because you asked me if I was responding to Jay. So
was that to Jay? I think we received something about 3 weeks ago.
Right.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were indicating something had come out just before the meeting today.
No, I think the thing is Jay tried to email it to all of us several days ago and must have gotten the wrong email off the website. So I would just suggest he re-email tonight. We'll give him the proper email, and then we can figure out sort of how to go about having a conversation about it. Maybe the Ordinance Committee discusses it, or what, however you want to handle it.
Right. I was under the impression it went to everybody because you specifically asked if I was going to answer
respond to the chair of the Ordinance
Committee. So I didn't look at who got it, but when I got an email from you, I just assumed everybody got it. So my apologies if not everybody got it.
Yeah, it was emailed to you on August 22nd.
Yeah. Addressed did it go to the whole council?
It did.
Yes. Yeah. And so we then followed up by emailing to Maureen, and she was away, and now then Ben to comment on, and we've been getting back and forth just recently. And so no time to do anything prior to coming to this meeting, so that's why we've said that if anything is going to change in the language, Jay has a month to research as a citizen what suggestions he like to make coming to the public hearing. That's what information I have.
Thank you.
Just as a point of clarification, the original email, which I do think we did all receive, was not as specifically directed to the issue of the short-term rentals part of the ordinance. I think that's why there might be some confusion here.
Oh. So is there a second to email?
No, no, I don't believe so. It just, Sarah commented about short-term rentals, but it has to do with creating an accessory building or a dwelling unit and turning that into overnight accommodations, which one would assume is kind of related to short-term rentals, I believe.
And the only reason I brought it up is because Maureen had requested, if possible, that we expedite this for various reasons on the work for the planning board. In other words, she doesn't want it to drag out for months.
Right.
And we assured her that we would try to do that. So instead of having the public hearing next month and then waiting a whole nother month, it would be extremely helpful to the planning board if we could vote next month. So that's why I asked, what is the procedure to merely incorporate a small question slash, it's not even a question, it's really a question from a citizen. I don't know the answer. How do we do that if we're already setting this for public hearing?
So if we set the public hearing, then I believe just as we have done tonight, we have the ability to vote, or as we may do at our public hearing on paper streets in October, we have the ability to have a vote on the item as a whole, or to make a motion to move one piece of it out of whatever it is that we're voting on at that meeting.
Great.
That is what I learned from Maureen this afternoon.
Am I correct in that?
Council can do whatever it wants after the public hearing.
Okay.
Thank you.
But I have very clearly heard that there are some concerns with the way that is packaged right now as one item within the overall package of technical amendments. So I'm going to hope that there will be some work done by the Ordinance Committee before it comes back for the motion.
No.
We'll have the public hearing.
It'll be at the public hearing, and then if something is brought up at the public hearing for the town council to consider, and they can ask that the Ordinance Committee, we could separate something out and ask the Ordinance Committee
meeting
to relook at our next meeting.
Okay.
But the problem is one of the people that Mr. Cox wanted to talk to is on vacation until later. So that's why we're going to set a public hearing and try and see what we could work out between now and the public hearing.
Okay.
And go from there.
Any other comments or questions on this item as a whole? No? Good? Kathy, did you have a question?
No.
No? Okay. Thank you. So all in favor of sending this to the public hearing next month? Any opposed? That passes unanimously. Thank you. We will move on to the election warrant. Deborah, can you introduce that item for us?
Sure, I'd be happy to. The election warrant calls for the municipal election on Tuesday, November 8th. There are two seats on the town council for a three-year term until December 9th, 2019, and two seats on the school board for a three-year term until December 9th, 2019. The election will be held again on Tuesday, November 8th at the high school gymnasium. Polls are open from 7 a.m. until 8 p.m. I just would note for people, if I could just take a minute, that absentee ballot requests are now available. We have created a link right on the town's homepage. On the right-hand side, there's a big check mark if you want to log in and request an absentee ballot. We also are accepting voter registration. Proof of residency and identification is required. We anticipate the ballots to be in sometime at the end of the first week in October. But if folks want to go on and request the ballots, we can mail them to them. People might want to consider that, being that we expect very long lines here in this chamber, and the process for absentee balloting is going to be quite long lines and wait. So if folks would like us to mail a ballot, we'd be happy to do so when we get them. So thank you for that little plug. So.
I'm glad that you gave that plug. Very helpful. Thank you. So do we have a motion to approve the election warrant for the November 8th, 2016 municipal election? Jamie.
I so move.
Thank you. Do we have a second? Thank you, Jessica. Any discussion, any questions for that, for Deborah? No? All in favor? Any opposed? No? We will move on. Thank you. I am going to ask here for a suspension of the rules to address some other items first before we come into a discussion on item number 116, because I'm anticipating that we will be moving into an executive session as part of that item. So do I need a motion for a suspension of rules?
Yeah.
Could I have a motion for a suspension of the rules?
Sure.
Thank you, Caitlin.
I move that we take items 117 and items 118 out of order and put item 116 last on the agenda.
Thank you. Do we have a second on that? Thank you, Jessica. Any discussion, or is that not debatable?
I don't think it is, but okay. I don't think they want to debate it anyway.
All in favor? Any opposed? All right, we will move on to number 117. Consideration of approval of grant application. And I think we have Mark Fleming here from the Conservation Commission who might introduce this item for us.
Sorry about the typo. It's requested. Good evening. My name is Mark Fleming. I'm representing the Conservation Commission. And we are requesting that the town make an application for a recreational trails program grant. This is from the Maine Department of Agriculture, Conservation, and Forestry. This grant would actually be to replace a bridge that used to be over Pollock Brook. That bridge is no longer there. The bridge, when it was made, was not adequate, basically, for its purpose. So at some point, it basically washed into the brook. As I said, this grant would be to replace that bridge. The location, I don't know if you have a map, but I can pass this around if you'd like.
Does anyone need a copy of that map?
No.
Okay. But I can show you. The bridge is basically located to the west of Spurwink Avenue, right near the intersection of Spurwink and Bowery Beach Road. Pollock Brook basically runs under Spurwink at that point and runs down to the marsh. If you're familiar with the area, this is basically very close to the area where 77 Bowery Beach Road goes over, and there's a bridge there, and there's a dock down in there. So the brook basically flows into that area. So as I said, this It's not really to add a new bridge. It's basically to replace a bridge that was always there, which provided public access to a very important and a very, very scenic area of the town. So we feel it's a very important thing to get this public access back. So I think you have a copy of the grant application, possibly. Yeah, should. Just if I could touch, I'll be willing to answer any questions, of course, but I thought I'd touch a couple of high points. Basically, if you look at page 3, we did have an extensive study that was done by the town engineer before this grant application was submitted. There were some, since there is saltwater marsh involved in there, there were some questions as to what types of permits would be involved. So if you look at page 3, it does outline the permitting is actually much simpler than we thought it would be. It's there. There is only a permit by rule needed from the state and a resource protection permit needed from the town. So if you look on page 4, it does give the main points exactly, what the bridge is supposed to do. As you can see here, it is to replace an existing bridge. It's going to be constructed so it has very limited or no impact to the marshland that's in the area. So the feasibility study did assure us of that. You can see there is a graveyard which is near the area, so there will have to be a historical survey done before we can proceed, but that's something that we're willing to do. The other point, I would just go to the financials. So if you look on page 11, it basically has the financials. The total amount of the project, if you look, is going to be $50,000. The amount of the grant that we're requesting from the state is $33,500. The rest of the money is going to be basically come out of the Conservation Committee's budget. So there is really no additional money that is going to be requested by the Conservation Committee in order to carry out this project.
Could I just interrupt for 1 second?
Yes.
With a quick question?
Absolutely.
I think our document says the Conservation Committee is recommending a total grant request of $50,000 with a cash match from the town of $13,500. So is the grant request, as this is written up, for $50,000 from the Bureau of, bear with me for a minute, or is it really $33,500 from the Bureau of Parks and Lands?
I think Maureen wants to comment on that.
What we're asking for is authorization for the full amount, and what we're trying to do is maximize the amount of cash match and in-kind match, and some of those numbers are still being finalized. But we're looking at a total grant application of $50,000 and a cash match that will come out of the Conservation Commission budget in the range of $13,500.
Okay. So the $50,000.
Some of the numbers are still being massaged.
So the $50,000 number includes not just this particular grant application, but also potentially some other in-kind contributions?
No, the $50,000 would just be for the bridge. And that's the total grant amount, and how much we're going to be using for in-kind. We get credit for volunteer hours. Hmm. We get credit for some assistance from Public Works. Those numbers are still getting massaged.
Okay.
But the total number would be $50,000.
Thank you for the clarification.
Any other questions for me? Hopefully I can answer.
I didn't have any more questions, and I think we'll take a motion, unless you have anything else that you would like to tell us to introduce the item. We may have questions for you, so just give us 1 minute.
Sure.
So could I have a motion on this item, which is to provide authorization to apply for a recreational trail development grant from the Bureau of Parks and Lands for the construction of Pollock Brook Bridge and Trail Project?
So moved.
Thank you. Could I have a second?
Yeah, second.
Thank you, Sarah. Discussion on that or any questions? No? No. I will just say, when I went to my first Conservation Commission meeting 3 years ago, this was on the agenda. We've been talking about it for a long time. I'm thrilled that you're moving forward with it. Shout out to Maureen and to the Conservation Commission. Good work. I look forward to, I hope this will pass, and I look forward to seeing this getting done. Thank you. Any other comments, questions? No? All in favor? Any opposed? That passes unanimously. Thank you for coming. And we will move on to item number 118, the Conservation Committee goals. Michael, are you going to introduce this item?
Yeah, this is primarily informational. The Conservation Commission submitted them, and just for the record, we put them on the agenda so you'd see them and know of them.
Great. So should we be looking for a motion to acknowledge receipt of them?
That would be right. And thank them.
Thank them for providing them and acknowledge receipt of those goals. Could I have a motion?
I move that we acknowledge receipt of the Conservation Committee goals.
Thank you, and thank you for that clarification on the committee. That's good.
And thank you for the clarification coming up.
Oh, I'm thanking you for clarifying that it's committee, not a committee.
You asked me to add it. She's thanking you for saying committee. Oh, committee.
Yes. We're still getting used to that terminology. Great. Do we have a second on that? Thank you, Sarah. Discussion? Yes, Jessica.
On the last page, at Lovett Woods, I think there's just a type error, but it may change meaning. It reads, a significant northern link to the Stone Gate Robinson Woods Trail system will acquire, securing public access. I think you meant to say was acquired.
And was acquired or will be?
Was or will be, but I...
So what about the same?
So I just, because it's a little confusing, I think it's worth clarifying for the record.
Maureen, can you clarify that? I'm reading...
I'm talking about
the Yes, and I'm looking at page 2. Since the adoption of the 2013 Greenbelt Plan, the town has made progress in implementing completed projects include the following, and that is on the list at Lovett Woods, so I assume that...
Completed project.
It's a significant northern link. Was acquired, securing public access.
Yeah, but Lovett Woods has been acquired, but the access... The northern access from Lovett Woods has not yet been acquired, but the actual will be acquired because we haven't passed papers yet.
So it needs a B in there?
It's a B.
Yeah, we can add B.
Word, just
will
just
be acquired.
Clear.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. You know, on that point, you know, the council has already authorized it to be acquired, but because of certain legal issues that needed to be resolved, one of the pieces that's significant has not yet been acquired.
Can I ask a quick question?
Yes.
Under Goal 3, and it talks about the missing links and they're by different neighborhoods, Gold Crest, Burwing South, Town Center. It says coastal 15, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, and 23. What are those coastal links? Missing. I didn't know what
those numbers refer to links in the Greenbelt plan. So the plan includes a map that shows trails in conceptual locations.
Right.
And it becomes impossible to have the conversation unless you give those links some kind of name.
Right.
So we gave them numbers.
And you don't know, because you're brilliant at this, where those links are?
I could show you where each one of these is now or at a future date.
Okay. I'm just curious.
Each one of them is in that 2013
I'd have to,
about plan.
Yeah, I'd have to pull that out. I was just curious. Maybe it was quick and easy off the top of your head.
Well, the individual numbers? Yeah. I wouldn't dare to do it off the top of my head. But I could pull a map up right behind you if you're really...
We'll go with future date.
We'll go with future date. Don't worry.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions? No? All in favor of the motion? Any opposed? Passes unanimously. We are at the end of items on the agenda. At this point, citizens may speak to any topic that's not on the agenda that pertains to Cape Elizabeth local government. Is there anyone here who would like to speak? No? Seeing none, I will look for a motion to return. I guess we don't need a motion to return back. We need to go to item number 116. This is on the town manager transition and advice on a non-related legal matter. I'd like to divide this into two two motions, if I could get those motions. The first one would be a motion for the council to authorize the town manager to contract with the firm as directed by the council and to pay those expenses for the transition, for that and other expenses of the transition from account number 715600. That authorization would be to move forward with our selection of the firm to assist us in our process, and we'll be discussing those applications tomorrow night at our workshop. If we have the motion tonight, when we make our selection tomorrow, the manager would have the authorization to go ahead and move forward with whichever firm we select. So that's the first motion. Could I have a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Caitlin. Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Discussion on that part of item number 116. No?
I just want to clarify. My role is simply to contract the firm services. The council will be the total consumer of that. I will not be involved in that process.
Thank you for that clarification.
Just to clarify so there's no confusion.
Yep.
Anyone who may be watching.
Thank you. Any discussion? No? All in favor? Any opposed? No? Okay. That passes unanimously. And now I will be looking for a motion for us to move into executive session pursuant to number one, MRSA, section 405, subsection 6, paragraphs A and C that will allow us to deliberate on an employment matter and to receive legal advice on another issue in town. Could I have a motion?
So moved.
Thank you. Could I have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Discussion? All in favor? Any opposed? We will move to the Jordan Conference Room for executive session.
May we?
And we are...